gyda Croeso yn y Prestatyn yn y Gymru, our online service for the 4th of October. And our theme today is murder in the vineyard. But more of that after our first hymn.
And this hymn is in memory of Marilyn Say, as we just had to listen to it at her funeral.
Jesus was teaching in the temple. He told the religious leaders to listen to this story. A landowner planted a vineyard. He built a wall around the vineyard and dug a pit for crushing grapes. He also built a tower. The landowner rented the vineyard to some tenants and left the country. When it was time for the harvest, the owner sent some servants to go get his grapes. But the tenants grabbed the servants. They beat up one servant, killed another, and threw stones at the third.
So the owner sent more servants to his vineyard, but the tenants attacked them too. Finally, the owner sent his son. He expected the tenants to respect him, but the tenants threw the son out of the vineyard and killed him. Jesus asked, "When the owner comes back to the vineyard, what do you think he should do to those tenants?"
The religious leaders answered, "They deserve to die. The owner should rent the vineyard to people who respect him."
A murder has been committed. Who, what, when, where, and why? It's time to investigate. It all took place after a landowner commissioned a new vineyard, which was completed with a wine press and a watchtower. Then he rented it out and went off on his journeys. The tenants were contractually bound to share some of the fruit of their harvest with him. That's the deal they signed up to. Okay, so there would be a lot of work on their part, especially in the early years when immature vines produce little or no fruit. But then a pattern starts to emerge that once the fruit do mature and the owner sends his representatives to collect his due, they get summarily sort of sent away or beaten up or even killed. There are lots of murders. So it looks like he thought in sending his son that they would respect him. Well, what happens next is hardly surprising. We find a corpse in the vineyard, or rather just outside the vineyard, and it was identified as the vineyard owner's son. The area is cordoned off as a crime scene with the evidence clearly labelled: victims, murder weapons, location, statements, alibis. No, not really. It's an open and shut case. Jesus uses parables to shake up his hearers, those who realise that they're actually in the story that Jesus is talking about. It was the religious leaders of Jesus' time who particularly feature here. They had just been asking him about his authority, and he'd asked them a question about John the Baptist, which they declined to answer. So he said, "Then I won't tell you," and instead told them this parable. So there are the main cast: the man, God the Father; the vineyard, Israel; the tenant farmers, Israel's leaders; the servants, the prophets; and the son, Jesus. It is Jesus, the storyteller, prophesying that he would be killed by those he came to save. Christians understand it this way. And the fact that he was killed outside of the vineyard is thought by many to be a reference to outside of Jerusalem, where Jesus was crucified. The bad tenants were the corrupt religious leaders and individuals then and now who don't give God his due, must listen to this parable and take it to heart. They can't continue to step around the evidence. That's the interpretation I want to focus on. So let me ask you this question. Where were you at the time of this crime? Have you got an alibi? And you might think, oh, 2,000 years ago. It's not actually that relevant. But this parable is lived out in each generation. There's a timeless quality in the words of Jesus for every man and every woman. So where were we in the story? Are we one of the servants that are sent to claim God's right? Are we one of these bad tenants that is just keeping everything that God has provided for ourselves, justifying it with the effort that we've put in? I think this is a parable that is especially poignant if you're someone that disregards God, those who perhaps don't even give God much thought. It's a warning that we do need to respond to all that he's given us. They are omitting to give God his entitlement. In not getting to know Jesus now, resurrected and alive, people who disregard him are living, well, with the evidence of that murder scene still around them, tiptoeing around the chalk marks, so to speak, but not actually checking it out, which I think makes them accessories after the fact. So we need to appeal to their sense of forensic examination. Get them to look at the scientific evidence, if that term has not lost its meaning during the pandemic. Whatever their approach, whether it's academic or philosophical or emotional, they need to be encouraged to consider Jesus for themselves, his death, the cause and the reasoning, and indeed his resurrection. So we are called to challenge those who currently disregard Jesus to open their eyes, to look at the evidence and consider where they are in relation to this murder scene. Are they denying God his share of the fruit of their lives? Another thing about parables, of course, is that we could sidestep them and say, oh, that's not relevant to me. But the message is surely clear. The landowner won't let the situation continue forever. We can't abuse his generosity, make use of his vineyard without paying our dues forever. The case of the murder in the vineyard will be tried, and all those who are accessories will be brought to justice. This is not a story. It is a true crime.
Turn our thoughts to prayer. Thank you, Father God, for providing the vineyard. We're sorry for all the ways that we may have rejected your servants, your prophets, or even your Son in our own lives. Help us to be those who encourage others to take you seriously, Lord Jesus, and make you a daily part of their lives too. Thank you for the comfort, strength, and guidance that you bring by your Holy Spirit at work in us. During this time of renewed restriction, help us to continue to be mindful and caring for one another, and especially those who have become reliant upon staying at home. Please speed the development of a good vaccine against COVID-19. We pray for all affected by this new level of restriction, the businesses, the unemployed, those pressured, the hospitals, the schools. Lord, we lift to you those on our prayer boards and ask your blessing. Please bless them, protect them, direct them, challenge them, and encourage them. We pray for Paul and Katie, hopefully getting married at Christchurch next Saturday. We pray for those with planned treatments and assessments and ongoing legal matters, those with thwarted plans or dashed hopes. We pray for Lou Alexander as he celebrated his birthday in the last week. Please bless him and his mum. We pray for Ken Say and others coming to terms with their recent bereavements. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Praise the Lord, the God who saves, even those who ignore his Son, even at this time. Hallelujah for the living God who dwells with his people. Bless his holy name, in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you wish to come to the church to pray this week, then the opportunities are on Wednesday at 1 till 3 at Christchurch, and then on Thursday at 11 to 1 at the Church of the Holy Spirit. There won't be an opportunity next Saturday as we have a wedding at Christchurch, and on Sunday there is the live service at the Church of the Holy Spirit at 10:30. Do come along if you'd like to those services, but you do need to book in advance. So that's the 11th at the Church of the Holy Spirit and the 18th at Christchurch, and then the 25th once more at the Church of the Holy Spirit.
Well, this is Almond. She is proving very popular, but I feel that sometimes she makes me look like a Bond villain. The notice for today mainly is, if you're watching this on Sunday morning, then there is a Zoom gathering at 2:30. This is particularly if you're in the mood still for harvest and that you haven't had the chance to sing along with any of the harvest hymns. So it'll just be a short 15-20 minutes. We'll just belt out three or four harvest hymns just so that we can celebrate this festival as fully as we can. So there's numbers on the screen I'll have put for both. There's a telephone number you can ring, so you can access it via telephone, and indeed if you access it online, there is the code for the correct Zoom room. So this is our Harvest Festival sing-along, just for a short time, 2:30 on the afternoon of the 4th of October. Well, that's all for this week. There will be just one or two little things at the end of our final song, so do stay tuned and not miss those. But do join us again next week. Next week the service will be online as before, and there will also be an all-age service at the Church of the Holy Spirit at 10:30 in the morning. But do please book your place if you'd like to be part of that. So until next time, keep safe, keep praying, and keep close to Jesus.
The Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. glory to the Lord on high. God wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy. Declare.